Good morning, guys. Welcome to Capitol Rivers Church. It's good to be together. If you've been joining us for the past few weeks or even just during this pandemic, we've been peering into the lives of our brothers and sisters all around our church. And today is going to be no different. We're going to be able to hear the welcome from some of our friends in Riverdale, Maryland, the sister's household over here. So come tag along and we're going to stay socially distanced. Come along with me.
Welcome to the Capitol Rivers Church. Welcome to our home, also called Low Hopes. I'm Ingrid, this is Casey, Monica, and Monica will start us off with a powerful scripture.
Romans 15, verse 13, it says, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit." And I love that the scripture talks about our God being a God of hope. I think during this time, it's been challenging to figure out just even where to put our hope. And it's amazing that we get to actually have a hope that is in eternity, a hope that is in actually spending forever with God and nothing of this earth. And again, that it is such a privilege that we get to actually have that.
Yeah. And some may know the story, some may not, but we have called our house Low Hopes for about 2 years now because when we were trying to re-sign the lease, everything was falling through. Like about six different times it fell through, and eventually we were trying to make it work, and it was the last day of our lease. I'm calling my landlord being like, it's not gonna work, like we're homeless, I don't know where I'm gonna move in, our electricity got turned off, it was totally crazy. But it's just been such a cool time of seeing God come in the clutch, that he really is the one who brings low hopes high. And also the thing that we can put our security in, like Monica was saying, that it's not about all the things working out the way I think they will, but I trust in God and he makes amazing things like this very sisterhood really come together and really work.
Yay, we'll start it up with a prayer. Yes. Dear Heavenly Father God, thank you so much for this time. I'm so grateful and thankful for these women that are in my life, Father God. We love each other very much. Sometimes we all drive each other crazy. Father God, I pray that you be with the preacher. I pray that you be with him, that you inspire him, Father God. I pray that we can just put our worries aside, Father God, whatever it is. I pray for your Holy Spirit to bright shine this day. Thank you so much for all of our blessings, Father God, and you don't deserve it. Thank you so much for Jesus and his blood. Thank you for all that you do for us, Father God. We love you, we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 I'm on my way. Good morning, Capital Rivers Church. It is great to be together again this Sunday morning. Thank all of you guys for joining us for our virtual worship service. As all of you guys know, tomorrow is Memorial Day, and it is a time where we do honor, but we also mourn for those who gave their lives for our country. So even before we get started, let's take a moment of silence, even just to remember the freedoms that we have in this country because so many lives were lost. Let's take a moment of silence. Amen. Now we're going to pick up in Genesis, in the book of Genesis, and we've started Genesis in January, and now we've picked up, we're actually in Genesis chapter 3. Last week, our title was Don't Take the Bait, and we talked about how Satan tempted Eve, and he found a way to tempt her through the back door, tempted her when she was alone because of her ignorance of the word, but also what he did is he is so crafty, he twisted her theology and her view of God. And after he did all that, she took the bait, she ate of the fruit, and the consequences that happened from that moment even felt throughout today. And what I want to look at today, we're going to continue in Genesis chapter 3, but my focus today and what I want to focus on this morning is what happened to mankind at that point. We know that the most significant thing that happened is that we lost this intimate relationship that we had with our God. You know, another thing that we also realized that from that moment on, that God's word did come true, that we did certainly die, that from that time we lost our eternity. And as you read in Genesis chapter 5, you'll see people living from 900 plus years and that we did die. And it, even now that we live up to maybe what, 80 something years. So we did die spiritually, but also physically. But there's something else that wasn't just lost, during that time, but there was something that's introduced into our lives at that time. And I believe that when we understand what happened at the fall and what happened, how it affects us today, that one of the things that we understand is, why do we do what we do when we sin? And there are things that we all do when there's sin in our lives that maybe we're not aware of, but there is at least three things that tend to enter into our lives that sometimes we even do by reflex and don't even know it. And I want to bring those things out for us today to hopefully help us to fight this battle that we're all in and these temptations, and really through Christ have these victorious lives that he has always wanted us to live out. Let's start our study in Genesis chapter 2, over in verse 25. You know, as God created man and woman, you know, as he ends all his creation, we looked at this last week, but in Genesis 2, verse 25, there's a verse here that I think brings light into what we're going to look at today. The Bible says in verse 25, Adam and his wife were both naked and they felt no shame. God's plan always for mankind is that shame should not be part of our lives. They were both naked, they were innocent, and they felt no shame. And now let's pick up in verse 6, and we see how everything from this moment on, from Genesis 2:25, begins to change, even their view of nakedness and shame. Look in verse 6. And when the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized that they were naked. So they sewed fig trees together and made coverings for themselves. Let's just stop right there. The moment they took a bite into that fruit, the effects were immediate. The Bible says that as soon as they ate, it says both of them, their eyes were open. Satan told them their eyes will be open, and what he told them was true. For the first time, their eyes were open, and the Bible says they realized, they became aware for the first time that they were naked. It was as if all of a sudden when they bit of the fruit, it was as if they eyes opened, they looked around at all creation and all the animals and all the angels. They felt that all the eyes of the angels and everything was looking at them. And for the first time in all of their lives, they experienced something in their lives. They felt shame. They became aware for the first time that they were naked, and that and internally something, they felt this shame, this feeling of humiliation that they had never felt and they were never intended to feel. And we understand, like little kids, they'll run around naked, they don't care. And I believe that's what they were like at the beginning, just running around in their freedom. But it was almost like when they bit of the fruit, they instantly became adolescents. They became self-conscious of how they looked. They felt this deep shame. They felt this deep embarrassment. And, you know, when I read this and they realized they were naked, one of the things that really hit me is that for the first time, I think we all understand this, that they understood shame. And there was three things that they did that we tend to do today just by reflex when we sin and shame is introduced in our lives. The first thing we do is what they did, is we cover up. My first point is we cover up. In Genesis chapter 3 and verse 6-7, it says, when the eyes of both of them were opened, they realized they were naked, so they sewed fig trees together and made coverings for themselves. Their first act, when they realized that they were naked, right? When they realized their innocence was lost, they realized that they felt shame, the first thing they did is they grabbed some leaves, they began to sew them together to cover themselves up. And it's the first time that mankind has ever tried to cover up deep soul issues with temporary things. And you know, and as I read this, and I can see this just by reflex, they thought, I'm naked, I'm going to do something about this myself. And I believe in even with us, if you're at home, if you're at home or you're in your bathroom and a child or a roommate walks into the bathroom and you're unclothed, your first reaction is to do what? You cover up. Why? Because there's something about being exposed that none of us like. And the first time that they felt exposed, their first reaction is let's find something, sew some fig leaves together, and let's cover up. You know, one of the challenges that we face when we sin and we feel shame is that we try to cover up our shame and our sin with external and temporary things. And sometimes we can use fig leaves, or we can use things that are only temporary to cover up things that are deeper in our heart and in our soul. You know, our society, it teaches us to cover up. It teaches us that if you feel shame or you feel sin, if you feel weakness, if you feel vulnerable, if you feel all these deep internal things, our society teaches us don't share those things, don't be exposed. But instead they say, hey, well, you need to cover those things up by working harder, by reading self-help books, by pouring yourself into something else. But our mindset and our culture says, you fix the problem. I think what Adam and Eve thought is like, look, I am naked. I feel shame. I'll fix this myself. And all of us know that these deeper things in our heart, no matter how hard we try to fix them, it's only putting a patch on a gaping wound. I remember even with my own lives, that when I felt sin and shame in my life, what I would try to do, my fig leaf would, let me hide behind my degree. Let me hide behind grace. Let me hide behind humor or reputation. Let me hide behind all these things, and I'll try to cover up on my and make it my own effort. But one of the things I realized that when I sat home and I sat in my room and I sat in a corner, I began to realize that only these temporary things that I try to cover up with, these man-made things to cover up the deep things in my heart, that it didn't work. And I still felt this deep shame and guilt that no matter what I tried to do, it couldn't. Those things, those fig leaves, those outward, external, temporal things, they were unable to cover up the things in my heart. Here's my question. What fig leaves are you trying to use to cover up the sin and the guilt and the shame in your heart? I want to let you know, whatever we're trying outside of Jesus Christ, anything we try to cover up our sin and deal with the guilt and the shame produced by sin, anything we try to use outside of Christ, because only He can restore innocence, anything, it's only temporary and it will not last. Even God understood this in Genesis 3:21. He says, the Lord God made garments of skin for Adam and his wife and clothed them. Even he says, look, in his grace and his love, says, these leaves cannot cover it up. I need to make you something more permanent. And what we have today is not physical things, but through Jesus Christ, we have Christ. In that, when the Bible says in Galatians 3, when we're baptized, we're clothed in him. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19, that he's able to cleanse us from all the internal, all the guilt that is inside. It's only in Christ that we can cover up the things of our soul. Adam and Eve tried to cover up on their own effort. It doesn't work. The only way that we can truly have a covering that will last and take away the shame is through a relationship with Jesus. Let's just keep going here. In verse 8, it says, when the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as they were walking in the garden in the cool of the day, they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to them, where are you? He answered. And Adam answered, I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked. So what did he do? The Bible says, so he hid. This is the first thing we do is we try to cover up through our own efforts. But the second thing sometimes we can do when there's sin and we feel shame is we begin, as our reflex, is we go and try to hide. When I read this passage, it makes me wonder, what was it like before the fall? And I can imagine as I read this, as the Lord God was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, that it was a time where Adam and Eve would run out and they would meet him, that there would be this intimacy and this love and this embrace. There was this joy, but when they bit of the fruit, instead of the joy that a child would have, like, I appreciate when I walk in, Olivia runs downstairs, she gives me a hug, and there's embrace. Instead of that pure joy that Adam and Eve once had when the Lord God walked with them for the first time, what the shame produced was fear and judgment. So now when he's walking through, now with that, when we sin, it produced, we begin to feel judgment and fear instead of acceptance and love in our relationship with God. You know, as we read this, and I look at this, Adam's response was, God said, well, where are you? He answered, well, I heard you. I was afraid. I was naked. So what do I do? What did he do? The Bible says he hid. You know, when you read this, you got to imagine those who read this for the first time, they probably, it was probably almost sad, but hysterical. It's like, how do you hide from God? How do you, what are you thinking that you think you can hide from the Creator, the one who's omnipresent? And even Proverbs 5:21 says, for your ways are in full view of the Lord. He examines all of your paths. So I'm sure for those who are reading it and they're looking at him, you were afraid and you hid. There's probably this sense, how do you hide from God? But the reality is for all of us is sometimes that's what we try to do. We sin and we shame, there's shame. And God is like, well, where are you? And instead of us, and he, I think the question, where are you, is almost saying, where are you? Where you should be is right here with me. We should be embracing. We should be in this place of love and intimacy. Well, what happened? Where are you? I think God was even in his grace trying to pull them out, but their feelings was, I've sinned. And now I'm afraid. I feel naked, so I'm going to hide. You know, my question for us today is, you know, God hasn't changed. God still walks through the cool of the day and he wants his relationship with us. But sometimes we have sin in our lives that is not confessed. One of the things that we'll do is we'll hide. And God is like, where are you? You should be here. And the question I ask myself as I read this, is there sin in my life that is now when I think and I hear of God, am I afraid? Do I realize that now that I'm exposed, do I hide instead of running towards him for the love and the intimacy and the forgiveness that he provides? You know, sometimes we can be like the story, this true story of a burglar. This burglar, he goes at this beachside place. He breaks into the place. And as he breaks into the place, he breaks in and he begins to ransack all the rooms. He takes all the loot. He puts it in his bag. And there's evidence that when he did that, he kind of just sat down. He sat down for a minute and he rested. But when he sat down, he saw on the shelf, it was a marble statue. And they know this because they found his fingerprints on the statue. There was a marble statue of the head of Christ with thorns around his head. And they found his fingerprints on the statue. What it is, he picked up the statue and he must have looked at it. But when he put it back, he turned it to face the wall, almost to say, Jesus, I don't want you to see what I'm doing. And sometimes we may not realize that, but we can try to conceal our sin and kind of think we can just turn Jesus away and we can hide. You know, something that is noteworthy to look in this passage. The Bible says that when they hid behind the trees in a garden. Isn't it ironic that it was the trees that gave Adam and Eve the chance to sin, and now it was those same trees that they're trying to hide behind to shield them from the presence of God? And I find that sometimes what we may try to do to deal with our sin and our shame, and instead of running to God and hiding ourselves in God and in Christ, sometimes what we tend to do, instead of going to Christ, we'll hide behind more sin that produces more shame. You know, a lesson we can learn as we read this is that, look, don't try to cover it up on your own. Don't go and try to hide even by some other place. The only place that we should run to is openness and nakedness and confession and vulnerability to the only one who can take our shame and our sins away. I love the passage over in Colossians chapter 3. And it's a good passage for us to just, even in those times, for us to think about. It says this in verse 1, since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above where Christ is seated. Seated at the right hand of God, set your mind on things above, not on earthly things, for you died and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. As Christians, if you are in Christ, if you've been baptized and raised in Christ, your life is now hidden in Christ. And in Christ, you are free to be naked, to run around in complete innocence. So even when you blow it, even when you sin and you feel the shame, don't hide. Run to Jesus. Run to him. And as he walks through the cool of the day, he will embrace you. He will love you. He will forgive you. And he will accept you. Don't cover up on your own efforts. Don't try to hide in the wrong places like other sin. But find yourself hiding in Christ. And finally here, if we keep reading, go back to Genesis chapter 3. The third thing that they did that is good for us to learn, even what we can do, is in verse 11, it says, and he said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from? The man said, the woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree and I ate it. Then the Lord God said to the woman, well, what is this you have done? And the woman said, the serpent deceived me and I ate. The third thing they did, you know what they did? They shifted the blame. You know, we do it by reflex sometimes. We'll cover up, we'll hide. And then when sin and we feel shame, what we do is instead of taking responsibility, we shift the blame. If you're home, raise your hand. If you find yourself in the midst of it, shifting blame. I know I've done that and I still do that. And I'm thinking, but God in his grace, and he asked him the question, who told you you were naked? And I believe the spirit of it, the spirit of what he was asking was another, I'm trying to draw you out. Who told you you were naked? Did you eat of the tree? I think Adam and Eve, as they were hiding, he was like, I'm trying to draw you out. The answer to the question, it was very simple. No one told you. The reason why they knew is because they disobeyed. And what the response should have been is, God, we confess we're hiding because we disobeyed. We didn't listen to your word. And now we feel naked and we feel shame. We feel sin for the first time. And I wonder if the story would have been different if they would approach God in his grace and just confess their sins. But I realize this, is that their response too often is our response. That rather than just coming out and saying, I ate, the man says, Adam says, the woman you put me here, he blamed the woman, but he also indirectly blamed God. It's like, God, you put her here. It's your fault, right? And just husbands, as a note, don't try that at home. Your wife is there because you asked her to be there. You got on a knee and said, you be here. I want you to be here. So don't ever blame that they're here, that they're there for some other reason. They're there because you asked them to be there, right? But also Eve here says, then the Lord said to Eve, and she blamed the serpent. You know, it's like the old joke goes, Adam blamed Eve. Eve blamed the serpent, and the serpent was left without a leg to stand on. Think about that. Get it? But I think that there's something here that we can get, is that we have to learn to take responsibility for our sins and not blame shift. You know, sometimes we blame our culture. Well, it's the environment we live in. That's why I do what I do. That's why I sin. We blame our genetics. Well, my family and my parents, we blame our upbringing. And if you know where I came from or what I've been through, this is why I do what I do. Instead of taking responsibility, we can blame it on so many things. Well, the reason why I blame the church culture, well, it's because it's the church. It has this culture. This is why I sin, right? We blame our small group leader. We blame, well, it's the evangelist. We blame people. And sometimes we act, well, the reason why I do is because other people, it's my spouse, it's my boss. And we instinctively sometimes, just by reflex, you know what we do? We shift the blame instead of taking responsibility. The Lord says here, who told you you were naked? Did you eat of the tree? Sometimes we have to learn, even sometimes, that the answer is yes, I did sin. And if you have children, and if you've been in this situation before, let me give you a hint. Here's where you know you're not taking responsibility and you're shifting blame. Think of the kid, right? Think of, you got donuts in your house. I got to go back to my Dunkin' Donuts, right? So imagine you have a donut in your house and there's one donut left and somebody, one of your children eats the donut. And you walk up to your kid and you say, did you eat the donut? And then all of a sudden, this is when you know it starts going off. When they say these words, well, what had happened was, and they start going to this, well, they start going to this whole story. Well, it was on the counter and it seemed like nobody wanted it. And you know, and the other kids passed it. As a matter of fact, you passed it too and you didn't eat it. So I thought it was for everyone. And then, you know, I didn't have a donut yesterday. So I guess since I didn't have one yesterday and you didn't want it, I guess we could have it, right? And then on top of that, I was walking by. I heard the donut call my name and the donut said to me, eat meat so I don't mold and go bad. So I felt it in me that I should eat the donut. Oh, yes, and yes, I did eat the donut. Now, as a parent, you laugh and you're thinking, why don't you just say you ate the donut? But you know, we do this too. What do you mean? Hey, did you just get angry and yell at your kids? Well, let me help you understand. Well, they were acting out. I was trying to do work and I was doing things and they were acting out. Did you yell at your kids? Were you inconsiderate with your wife? Were you unloving to your wife? Well, you should have heard her tone and how she responded. And if she would have responded, did you now disrespect your husband? And your, well, if he would stop acting like a child, that also is his fault. Now, were you impure? Was there a hint of impurity? Well, everybody else is doing it. And we just sometimes instinctively, like our first parents, we can tend to blame instead of taking responsibility for our sin. You know, my encouragement, what we can learn here is that all of us feels naked at times. We all feel the shame. We all go through these different things and where sin, it feels guilt. But I think what the spirit of this, even God's question, who told you you were naked? The response is, let's learn to take responsibility. Let's learn to be open and confess and come running to a God that says, I want to forgive you, accept you, and love you, and not cower in fear and go through all these mental gymnastics instead of just saying, yes, I blew it. And I believe God will say, I love you. And the reason why I know as we prepare for communion is that Jesus decided 2,000 years ago, I'm going to take responsibility. I'm going to take the blame for their sin. And instead of eating from the tree, instead of hiding behind the tree, he says, I'm going to go up the tree and be shamed and be ridiculed to take on all the blame for all of those who have hidden themselves in me. You know, we have an amazing, amazing God. And through his son, we can freely come before him without shame, our guilt, and our failure. And he understands. The Bible says here in Galatians and Colossians chapter 2, it says this in verse 13. It says, you were dead in your sins, and your sinful desires were not yet cut away. Then he gave you a share in the very life of Christ, for he forgave all your sins. and blotted out the charges proved against you. The list of his commandments, which you had not obeyed. He took this list of sins and destroyed it by nailing it to Christ's cross. Jesus has done all the work. He has taken on all the sin. He has taken the blame. What we need to do is freely live our lives as children, naked and innocent and freedom in Christ. Let us now, as we take communion, if there is sin, let's take responsibility, confess it, and repent. Let this be a time as we go before the foot of the cross that we don't try to cover up and try to do it on our own, that we don't try to hide in places and hide and get into more sin and deeper shame, nor do we take this time to blame someone else. Let us take this time to be completely naked and open and free and exposed before our great God. Amen. Hopefully some of these thoughts will help us as we go before the cross. Amen. Thank you.
Brian here, talking about Bald for Bucks. I know Lauren and I got on social media a few days ago and said tonight at 8 was the day we were going to go bald, but it's not happening today. We stay tuned, we'll let you know when I am actually gonna go bald. It is being rescheduled. Someone else is going bald tonight. And so yeah, we'll find out, we'll figure it out, and we will definitely let you know. But Bald for Bucks is 10 days left. It's gonna end the end of May. We're gonna end the fundraiser. Right now we're over 40,000. We are less than 10,000 away from COVID-19 relief through Bald for Bucks. Super encouraging, so exciting. Please continue to give, help the poor, help those who are in way more dire needs than we are, even during this time. What a great opportunity to be generous. So thanks so much for the generosity you've shown so far. Stay tuned for the rescheduling of my Going Bald for Bucks. Thanks so much.
Find out about more events going on the Capitol Rivers Church, and if you'd like to support our ministry, log on to our website at capitalriverschurch.org.
Yo, Yanni, you gotta check out this video, bro. Like, we could do this dance.
Right, bro.
I don't even fucking do it.
Bro, I'm telling you,
bro. Come on, dude. Like, we believe in you, bro. Like, we can do this.
Bro, we can literally do this dance.
Right. You know what? I got this.
Let's go. Let's go.
Walking around these walls, and I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle. Still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence, you never fail me, yeah. I know the night won't last, your word will come to pass, my heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough, keep me within. Still stands. still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. Never failed me yet.